Our reading today is from Acts chapter 1, verses 6 to 14. Then they gathered around him and asked him, "Teacher, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom of Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or dates the Creator has set. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." After he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. "Men and women of Galilee," they said, "why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven." Then the apostles returned to Jerusalem from the hill called the Mount of Olives, a Sabbath day's walk from the city. When they arrived, they went upstairs to the room where they were staying. Those present were Peter, John, James, and Andrew, Philip, and Thomas, Bartholomew, and Matthew, James, son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, son of James. They all joined together constantly in prayer, along with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brothers. Amen.
Thank you. Let's pray. Dear God, I ask that you would open our hearts, our minds, our souls, to hear what we might in these moments that we sort of reflect and pause on the ancient texts that have been handed to us as we wrestle and grapple with things we don't understand, trying to make sense out of why we're here, what this is all about, where it's going, and what should we be doing. I know, simple questions. But we ask that you would speak to us as only you do and you can, as we attempt to listen. And it's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. So the reading this morning is the beginning of the book of the Acts of the Apostles in the New Testament. And this is the prelude for what will come next week in our church year as we celebrate what is considered the birth of the church, the beginning of the church, which is the Feast of Pentecost. Now, when the Feast of Pentecost was decided, they didn't know it would be Memorial Day weekend here in the United States. And so many of you will be traveling, but we will celebrate Pentecost next Sunday. And the text that was for today from our lectionary starts at verse 6 of Acts chapter 1. And the previous verses, which were not part of the reading, but I think have part to play in what I would like to share with you. So the story is, as it has been given to us for centuries, Jesus died on Good Friday, as we know. He was crucified. 3 days later, Easter Sunday morning, he rose from the dead. Then for about 40 days, he sort of pops in and pops out of people's lives. It's really mysterious. And the text in Acts tells us that during that 40 days, as Jesus was popping in and popping out with his friends after the resurrection, he spoke to them constantly about this concept that the Bible refers to as the kingdom of God. Now, because we are gender inclusive in our language here, particularly about things spiritual, we use the code word kingdom of God, because kingdom makes reference to a man and a king and patriarchy and all that stuff that in many ways we're trying to free ourselves from. And so we use the code word kingdom, a realm, a place where we are all together. So I will probably slip up because I'm an old man and have said kingdom for as long as Don Seabart's been alive. So I may slip, but you get the idea. We're trying to avoid the patriarchy of the language and realize this is an all play. It's the kingdom where all women, men, people of whatever sexual orientation are welcome. And this is a sanctuary, a safe place for people of all colors and stripes and ages and education or not, money or not. This is everyone's sanctuary, as we like to say every week. So to help me ferret through this text given to us, I was provoked a couple of weeks ago by John Love's wife, Marilyn, and, well, provoked. She chided me, she was really kind, and she made the observation, you never quote any women. Don't you read any feminist theologians? And it got me to thinking, good golly, busted. I'm sure John Love has had that feeling many, many, many times in the years of their marriage. So I talked to T.G. and Wendy. I need to start reading some women theologians. Who do you suggest? And so they suggested Cynthia Bergerow, I believe is how you say her name. So I'm reading her book, The Wisdom of Jesus, which is really helpful. I'm enjoying it quite a bit. And so there's a couple of things from her reading of the life of Jesus I want to bring to us this morning for our consideration. And part of this all stems from really that first couple of verses in our text, where it says, you know, they gathered around Jesus and they said, okay, Jesus, are you at this time going to inaugurate the kingdom of God? And because Jesus had been talking to them for 40 days about this concept. And when you read the Gospels, it is the major theme of what he talked about for 3 years of his public ministry. Every parable in the New Testament is a reference to this concept of the kingdom of God. Now, theologians of all stripes have written about what does that concept mean? And I don't have a lot of answers for that, but it is something I have thought, prayed, and studied about for years. And I'm thinking, because it is so significant and so important, that I'm going to break away from the lectionary for our summer months and spend some time looking at the parables of Jesus and what they have to say to us about this concept of the kingdom of God. What is the kingdom of God? What is that about? Because Jesus was talking about it all the time. And so the friends of Jesus gather and say, okay, is this it? Are you finally going to kick those stinking Italians all the way back to Rome? We can get our country back. We can live as we want. We can do what we want. Is this the time of the end? They're looking for the big answer. Is it all going to happen now? And I imagine Jesus said something like, oy vey, slapped his head, ascended into heaven, as the text tells us, went up, was caught in the clouds. The friends of Jesus are gobsmacked, standing there with their mouths, what now? And then two angels appear saying, relax, just stay here. The Spirit's going to come, we'll teach you all things. And so they go away into a room. I believe they drove back into Jerusalem in a Honda, because the King James says they were all in one accord. At any rate, they go back and they don't know what's going on. They're confused. He's gone now. Now what? Now what? Because they wanted conclusion. We long for conclusion. We want everything tied up with a bow. Make sense of it. Okay, now we can move on. Bring it together. We all want that. They wanted that. And it was not to be. And so Jesus left and said, stay here because my Spirit is coming. And then it's the angels tell the followers of Jesus, you will be his witnesses. And that's the same word, by the way, that martyr comes from. The Greek word for a witness is to be a martyr. It's martyrio. So the word martyr is the word witness. And they're about to find out how the two are so conjoined as the history unfolds. But that you will be his witnesses here in Jerusalem, then Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. And that's really it's like a table of context for this whole book of Acts in the Bible. They first are witnesses in Jerusalem, then Judea, then Samaria. Philip goes to Samaria, and then Paul and Peter go to the ends of the earth with this message of Jesus and this message about the kingdom of God. And so in the Cynthia Bergerow book I mentioned that Marilyn Love got me onto, one of the things she brings forward that I love, it's helpful, she suggests, that we rethink what we think we know about Jesus. And so much of us growing up in church, as some of us have, you know, we're taught Jesus is divine. He came, he died for all of our sins so we could all go to heaven. We've been taught creed and doctrine about who Jesus was and is and ever shall be. And while some of that may be functional for some of us, for some it is not. And she really brings forward this beautiful concept that I love. Jesus, in the tradition of the day, would really have been seen as a wisdom teacher. And a wisdom teacher, there's a long history of wisdom teachers in the Jewish tradition, which Jesus lived and grew up in and worked in. And wisdom teachers have three basic elements about what it is they do. They're not lawgivers. They're not code enforcers. Wisdom teachers help us reflect on who we are, why we are, and what we're about. And they do this utilizing three basic tools. They listen to what people are concerned about. They ask questions, which good rabbis have always done. Good rabbis always ask provocative questions. I mean, the old Woody Allen joke is, you know, why does a rabbi, you know, a congregant goes to the rabbi and says, "Rabbi, why is it you always answer a question with a question?" And the rabbi strokes his beard, looks at the man and says, "Why shouldn't a rabbi answer a question with a question?" That's just the way rabbis taught. Because when you ask questions, you make people think. Socrates did that quite a bit. Zen masters do it with their koanic stories. So listening, asking questions, and then the third thing, they tell stories. And Jesus told a lot of stories, and we're going to look at those over the summer months, the stories. But the goal of the wisdom teacher is to help us look inward and to see who we are and what we're about and why we're about and what motivates us, so that we can live the gift of life wisely and that we can make the most out of the moments we are given, helping each other along the way. So these are some of the things I'm picking up and reading about Jesus, the wisdom teacher. And so that's why I want to look at the parables over the summer. Now, this concept of the kingdom of heaven, I just want to give you a couple of teasers about this. And if you're going to plan to come or listen to the sermon series about these parables, I hope you don't think I'm going to have a lot of answers. I will try to be my best rabbinic Fred that I can be and pose a lot of... I think of it as questioning our way into faith. Because I don't know that there are a lot of answers. So, to the kingdom. One of the great influences in my life has been another Cynthia Bergeault is an Episcopalian priest, and another Episcopalian that I have found quite helpful for me personally is a man named Robert Farrar Capon, who wrote a massive book on all of the parables of Jesus and how they reference the kingdom. And Capon says, the kingdom of God is beyond our ability to fully comprehend. But there's five statements, according to the parables of Jesus, that we can say about this concept, the kingdom of God, that was so important to Jesus that he tried to teach us about. And the five things are, number one, it is mysterious. It's beyond our language. It's beyond our mind's ability to conceptualize completely, but we can in part. So it's mysterious. Secondly, it is everywhere all the time. So it is not geographically bound to a church building or to a country. That the kingdom of God is everywhere all the time. Thirdly, it has its own power and energy. You don't help it out. You don't give it a boost or a hand. It has its own energy within itself. In fact, that energy can shape us and include us in what it is doing. Fourthly, when you bump into or have an experience with the kingdom of God, when it breaks in to the time and place you are occupying, it demands an immediate response. You just can't say, well, I'll think about that, or it's not a bad... When you encounter an experience with the kingdom of God, it demands an immediate response, because number five, it penetrates into a world system that is diametrically opposed to it. We live in the world of empire, where the more money you have, the better off you are, the more power you have, making others do what you want. That's the world system we grow up in. You better have the right color skin to get ahead. You better have the right sexual orientation to be accepted. We live in a in a world system that segregates and discriminates and pits human beings against human beings. And the kingdom of God opposes all of that. And so there is this conflict. So those are some of the things, as a teaser, we'll look at in the summer. Now, Cynthia Bergerow has these great lines about the kingdom of God that I just want to share with you. Some people think the kingdom of God is heaven, and when we die, we go there. Or others think it's a utopia that we're supposed to try to craft, that it's up to us to make it happen here and now, to make justice happen, to do things, to make the kingdom come. And she says it's really not either of those things. She has this great line. She says, you don't die into the kingdom. You awaken into it. And it's not a place you go to. It's a place you come from. So that when you have an experience of the kingdom of God, it changes how we live and operate in this world. We see everything differently. We behave differently because we realize there is a greater reality than our five senses can tell us about. And so it changes us from the inside out. And she suggests that what it really does is helps us clue in to the non-dual interrelatedness of all of creation. Now that may sound a little new agey, but I think she's on to something. Because we're all stardust. Everything is stardust. It's all interconnected. And we are all interconnected. And that's why we help others along the way, because we realize we're helping ourselves as well. Because there really is not this massive difference between us. We're all in this together. And when you have an experience with the kingdom of God, it changes you to realize that. That's why in Acts chapter 2, they shared everything they had together, because they realized they were all in it together. And when you have that awareness, it changes how you live and act and behave and drive your car and go to work and all that stuff. What you watch on the internet, it changes all of that, because we realize there's more to reality than what my five senses are telling me. And we're clued in. It changes us. So that's the kind of stuff we'll look at over the summer with what Jesus may teach us. Now, another theologian that's been hugely impactful on the study of Jesus was a man named Albert Schweitzer. And in the early 1900s, he started a project of looking for the historical Jesus, not the risen Christ, but the Jesus that walked the dusty pathways of Palestine. And it's almost impossible to do. I mean, you can't. But what he came to was the conclusion that every generation sort of fashions Jesus into their own image. And in that way, we keep him alive. That every culture, I have one of the things I have on my computer at home, I have all these different pictures of Jesus of all different races, because everybody makes a Jesus that looks like them. So there's a Polynesian Jesus and an African Jesus and a white European Jesus and a Middle Eastern Jesus and all these pictures, because we all, to try to connect, to understand. And so I'm not going to suggest that I know the one, the only, the real Jesus, and you need to listen to me. I think that's arrogant and silly. And so what is it I'm suggesting? I'm like the disciples. You know, we can come to a place like this. All right, give us the answers. How's it end? What are we supposed to do? Is this the time? And I think Jesus would stand before us today and go, oy vey. But I think the response he would give to us is the same response he gave to the first disciples that came to him in the Gospel of John. In the Gospel of John, some followers of John the Baptist had heard about Jesus, and they went to find him, and they said, all right, what's all this about? Give us the answers. And Jesus looked at them and said, come and see. Come and see. So as a pastor in a church, I can't promise you answers to all of your big questions, but I can offer you an invitation.
as together we come to this place, we collect our monies, we help others along the way, we try to be nice to each other, we wrestle with the ancient texts that have been given to us, we try to figure out how to be alive in this time and place, and do it in concert with the Spirit of God that we'll talk about next Sunday for Pentecost. As we try to do all this, maybe it will unfold and we'll learn what it's all about as we travel along the way with this mysterious Jesus, the wisdom teacher. So all I can say is, come and see, and we'll all learn together. Amen.